did not let my foes rejoice over me. O Lord my God, I cried to you for help, and you have healed me. O Lord, you brought up my soul from Sheol, restored me to life from among those gone down to the pit. Sing praises to the Lord, O you his faithful ones, and give thanks to his holy name. For his anger is but for a moment, his favor is for a lifetime. Weeping may linger for the night, but joy comes with the morning. As for me, I said in my prosperity, I shall never be moved. By your favor, O Lord, you had established me as a strong mountain. You hid your face, I was dismayed. To you, O Lord, I cried, and to the Lord I made supplication. What profit is there in my death if I go down to the pit? Will the dust praise you? Will it tell of your faithfulness? Hear, O Lord, and be gracious to me. O Lord, be my helper. You have turned my mourning into dancing. You have taken off my sackcloth and clothed me with joy, so that my soul may praise you and not be silent. O Lord my God, I will give thanks to you forever. The New Testament reading is Revelation 5, verses 11 to 14. Then I looked, and I heard the voice of many angels surrounding the throne and the living creatures and the elders. They numbered myriads and myriads and thousands, singing with a full voice, "Worthy is the Lamb that was slaughtered to receive power and wealth and wisdom and might and honor and glory and blessing." Then I heard every creature in heaven and on earth and under the earth and in the sea and all that is in them singing, "To the one seated on the throne and to the Lamb be blessing and honor and glory and might forever and ever." And the four living creatures said, "Amen." And the elders fell down and worshiped. The New Testament reading is John 21. Verses 1 to 19. After these things, Jesus showed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he showed himself in this way. Gathered there together were Simon Peter, Thomas called the Twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples. Simon Peter said to them, "I am going fishing." They said to him, "We will go with you." They went out and got into the boat, but that night they caught nothing. Just after daybreak, Jesus stood on the beach, but the disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, you have no fish, have you?" They answered him, "No." He said to them, "Cast the net to the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because there were so many fish. That disciple whom Jesus loved said to Peter, "It is the Lord." When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on some clothes, for he was naked, and jumped into the sea. But the other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, only about 100 yards off. When they had gone ashore, they saw a charcoal fire there with fish on it and bread. Jesus said to them, "Bring some of the fish that you have just caught." So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And though there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, "Come and have breakfast." Now none of the disciples dared to ask him, "Who are you?" because they knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them and did the same with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus appeared to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my lambs." A second time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He said to him, Yes, Lord, you know that I love you. Jesus said to him, Tend my sheep. He said to him the third time, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter felt hurt because he said to him the third time, Do you love me? And he said to him, Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you. Jesus said to him, Feed my sheep. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you used to fasten your own belt and to go wherever you wished. But when you grow old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will fasten the belt around you and take you where you do not wish to go. He said this to indicate the kind of death by which he would glorify God. After this, he said to him, Follow me. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Grace to you and peace from God, our Heavenly Father, and His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Where is Jesus? Now that's the question that was on everyone's mind after the resurrection. Where is Jesus? He appears in the garden to Mary, in the upper room to the disciples, again in the upper room to Thomas and the others, and then with the disciples on the Emmaus Road. Where is Jesus? Why, he's here, he's there, he's everywhere. Today's Jesus sighting takes us to the Sea of Galilee. The disciples had packed up their Jerusalem bags and had gone home. Home to where they had labored. Home to the base camp out of which Jesus had coordinated and conducted his ministry. What's that old saying? There's no place like home. Especially when you've been traumatized by the crucifixion, startled by the resurrection, and now just kind of generally perplexed and confused by what comes next. Let's get out of this place, they must have thought. That's what they probably said to one another. We got to get out of this place. Please, 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 let's just go home. And home they go. They go back to the steady, to the predictable, to their reconnection with their personal histories. Back to the Sea of Galilee they go. And of course, knowing the fellas, they go fishing. Not just because they know how to do it, not just to earn some money, but you see, for them it was commonplace. It was the thing that they knew how to do, especially when they were overwhelmed by life. When they were overwhelmed by life, they went fishing. Some fellas here today do the same. They withdrew and they engaged in concrete activities that they could do without too much thought. Some good, hard work, some concrete work that would help them reboot, that would help them sweat it out, get beyond the churning of one's own life and one's own internal condition. They went fishing. There were seven of them. Peter, Thomas, Nathaniel, the two sons of Zebedee, James and John, and two other disciples, probably Andrew and Philip, just after daybreak, while there's still that early morning haze. Guess who shows up? Jesus. Now, despite their knowing how to fish, they had caught nothing. They had come up with zip, zilch, nada. And Jesus says from the shore, Hey fellas, cast your net to the right side of the boat. I wonder if that's when they
they started to figure out who it was. See, he had done this before. He liked to mess with them that way. So they cast the net, and their nets are filled with fish, heavy to the extreme, but the nets hold, and when they haul the nets in, there are 153 fish. Now, throughout history, theologians, especially the great church fathers, made a lot out of these numbers. Seven disciples, 153 fish. What did it all mean? Cyril of Alexandria said that the 153 stood for all of the Gentile world, 100, half of the Jewish world, 50, and the Trinity, 3. I guess that's what you did back in those ancient days. Now, St. Augustine, much more modern, said, if you add the numbers 1 through 17, you get 153. And 17 stood for the law, the Ten Commandments, 10. And the number 7, the holy number, stood for grace. Completion. Way to go, Augustine. But of course, Freeborn says, it's 153 fish. Get on with it. And the point of it all is that they counted the fish because they were probably precursors to the Presbyterians. We count our fish. But the point of the story is that when Jesus is guiding your life and directing you, it is amazing, absolutely amazing, the way that you can do a lot with a little. Following Jesus means you can do a lot with a little. Surely Augustine and Cyril would agree with that conclusion. But isn't it interesting how we make the simple so complex in our lives and in our theologies? Especially when we find ourselves in times of heightened anxiety, times when we are confused, times when we are uncertain, we might ask ourselves, why were these experienced professional fishermen having such a terrible time filling their nets until Jesus showed up? Might it not have been their own inner anxiety, their inner confusion, their inner uncertainty that contributed to their lack of success? Might we therefore also ask ourselves today as we gather, if we are having trouble claiming doing a lot with a little, might it be our inner anxiety, our inner confusion, our inner uncertainty that has forgotten the simple fact that with Jesus in our lives, we can do a lot with a little. But when we see Jesus, and when Jesus settles us down, when he instructs them, when he instructs us, and when they obey, and when we obey, success, 153 fish. Might this story be about unfinished business? Might this first part of the story be to remind us that when Jesus is with us, concentrate on the simple fact that he's with us and get on with it and do a lot with a little. The story continues. John recognizes Jesus. Peter jumps into the sea. He goes to welcome Jesus. He's eager to be the first to greet the Lord and to perform the welcoming ceremony of hospitality, which is always understood in Judaism as a religious act. He dresses as he jumps in the water. Once they all come together to to shore, Jesus offers them breakfast. They dine together, reminiscent of Holy Communion. The point is, don't think that Jesus is some kind of a ghost, a specter, a vision. No, Jesus is alive in bodily resurrection, discovered and claimed through the communal act of eating together. He is real. And then the story comes to its great conclusion. Simon Peter, who denied Jesus, denied knowing the Lord three times, is asked now by this same resurrected Lord, "Do you love me more than these? Do you love me? Do you love me?" And just as Peter denied him three times, he now publicly affirms that he loves his Lord Jesus Christ. Each affirmation is more specific than the last. He loves Jesus more than these. He is going to tend Christ's sheep. He is going to feed Christ's sheep. He is going to love Christ's lambs. And in that moment of unfinished business, Jesus reinstates Peter and replaces the memory of denial, betrayal, and failure with a threefold public affirmation of unquestionable love and devotion and an understanding of what living in that love means. Living in that reinstated love, Peter affirms that Christ comes first. The sheep shall be tended. The sheep shall be fed. Living in the love of Christ means it's up to him, up to you, up to me, up to us to do these things. It is not enough to not just deny Christ. We must love him, and we must serve him. Jesus drives this point home in the most powerful way that I can imagine. In the last verses of our text, he tells Peter how Peter's life will end. He tells Peter, "Follow me to death and beyond." And those same words that he spoke so many years ago, he speaks again. "Follow me." Oh yes, this is a story of unfinished business. It reminds us that in Christ we can do a lot with a little. It reminds us of the incredible grace of God in Jesus Christ. It reminds us that in the communion that we celebrate, we know Christ is alive and that the resurrection is a bodily resurrection. And it reminds us that Christ wills to replace our memories of sin and failure with memories of public profession of love, of tending, and of feeding Christ's sheep. So let us love Christ. And let us remember that love brings a task, a commitment to tend the sheep, to feed the sheep. You do a lot with a little. Love Christ, and remember as well
that love also brings a cross. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and